But I will remind you now, at this moment, what, in fact, the motion is again. It is that the atheism is the new fundamentalism. Well, let's get straight on. And we're going to start with Richard Harris. Richard Harris, former Bishop of Oxford. Richard.
Good evening, everybody. It's very natural for parents to be proud of their children, and three mothers were once discussing their achievements. One said, "My son's an ambassador. When he comes into the room, he's addressed as Your Excellency." To which the second mother responded, "My son's a cardinal. When he comes into the room, people call him Your Eminence." The third mother simply said, "My son is 6 foot half and a half feet tall with shoulders as wide as a barn. When he comes into the room, people get to their feet and say, My God." Obviously, nobody here believes in that kind of God. And this poses the question of what God we have in our minds when we say we believe or we do not believe. That is the question, ladies and gentlemen, at the heart of this debate. What kind of God do we accept or reject? Because there are many, many different kinds of atheism. So let me begin by emphasizing that I understand all too well and have the deepest respect for certain forms of atheism. The atheism of Camus in La Peste or Ivan Dostoevsky in The Brothers Karamazov haunts and challenges believers, perhaps even more than unbelievers. That kind of atheism is an all too plausible view of the universe. But what we're dealing with this evening is what has been termed the new atheism, associated particularly with its attack dogs, Daniel Dennett, Christopher Hitchens, and very sadly from my point of view, my friend Richard Dawkins, who writes such wonderfully inspiring books on science. So it is not atheism as such which is being debated this evening, which in some forms I very deeply respect, but this new atheism that is the new fundamentalism. Now, I would suggest that fundamentalism has four main characteristics. First of all, it's impervious to the facts. Nothing is allowed to count against it. Creationism, the belief that the world was created in a very short time, as it were, ready made, is denied by every possible branch of science, cosmology, paleontology, geology, etc., etc. But apparently the combined results of all these scientific disciplines refuses to shift the creationists. But fundamentalism doesn't only take a religious form. It took a political form in Soviet-style communism, and I think we'll all be aware of that, so I'm not going to elaborate it. Now, it seems to me that the new atheism has this feature of fundamentalism, is that it simply does not allow the case, the strong case, to count in any way at all. It ignores the fact that the greatest philosophers in Western society down the ages for 2,000 years or more have either been religious believers or have had a philosophy which points to religious belief. They simply do not take that into account. They ignore the fact that the great inspiration behind Western art over countless centuries has been the Christian faith, and it continues to be so. The two poets universally regarded as the greatest poets of the 20th century, T.S. Eliot and W.H. Auden, were both serious Christians. Today you could count half a dozen or more of the world's greatest composers who are passionate about the Christian inspiration of their music. James McMillan, Arvo Pärt, John Taverner, to just mention three. But all this, the new fundamentalists, simply seem to block out of their minds altogether and don't let it count against them. And this leads to the second feature of fundamentalism. It always picks on the weakest points in another person's arguments. But is it not true that if you're really confident of your case, you face the opponent's strongest argument? You don't simply always focus on their weakest arguments. And then thirdly, this points to the kind of God which is so often criticized. Many of you will have read Philip Pullman's wonderful, wonderful book, The Dark Materials. But can you remember the kind of God that is pictured in that? A kind of wizened old human being, nothing better. And as a young child said once when they read that book, I never believed in that kind of God, and nor do Christian believers. And this points to the fourth and final reason why the new atheism can be described as the new fundamentalism. And that is, it focuses only on the kind of God in whom creationists believe. It looks as though religious fundamentalism and atheistic fundamentalism need each other and feed on each other. What would happen if they actually moved away from a focus upon that creationist God, upon what you might call the God of classical Christian theism? And these four features of fundamentalism, whether it's religious fundamentalism or atheistic fundamentalism, means that there is a great lack of what the 19th century poet Robert Browning called the grand perhaps. There's a wonderful long poem of Browning called Bishop Blougram's Apology, where he spends all night talking with an atheist. And he says to the atheist at one point, "How can we guard our unbelief, make it bear fruit to us? The problem here, just when we're safest, there's a sunset touch, a fancy from a flower bell, someone's death, a chorus ending from Euripides, and that's enough for 50 hopes and fears of old and new at once, at nature's self to rap and knock and enter our soul. The grand perhaps." Ladies and gentlemen, they don't allow that grand perhaps. And surely, that's one of the features of fundamentalism. They don't really allow that to count against them. The kind of God I believe in is very, very different from the kind of God which they are attacking. It's the kind of God which is revealed for me at the end of Rabbi Hugo Grin's great autobiography, where he says he was in Auschwitz as a child. He hoped God would rescue him. That God never came, and he cried and cried for hours, and then he realized that, as he says, "People sometimes ask me, where was God in Auschwitz? I believe that God was there himself," he said, "violated and blasphemed. The real question is, where was man in Auschwitz?" So I suggest that the heart of this debate is the kind of God we do believe in or do not believe in.
But now we're going to go straight on to A.C. Grayling, our very well-known philosopher, academic author, author of Against All Gods, apart from other books. A.C. Grayling.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, there is a confrontation between people who have religious commitment and those who don't. And it has become a rather bad-tempered one since 9/11, since the atrocities in New York and Washington. In 2001. And that date, what happened on that date, I think changed the nature of the debate between people on either side of this confrontation. Prior to it, I think if people had a religious commitment of some kind, generally speaking, in this country at least, they kept it to themselves. Their religious proclivities were rather like their sex life. They didn't talk about it at dinner parties very much. And when one met somebody, if one wasn't oneself religious, who is religious, one wouldn't press the point very much. One would treat them rather as if there had been a death in the family, which in the case of Christianity is reasonably apt. since 2001, however, things have changed. And they've changed in that people who don't have a religious commitment have very often spoken out robustly and uncompromisingly and have been very frank about their point of view. And it is this, I think, the tone of the discussion which has alarmed people who are defenders and apologists for religion. And it puts me in mind, rather, of a cartoon I saw recently which has two panels. And in the first panel, there is a cleric, and he's brandishing a religious symbol of some kind, as it might be a crucifix if he's a Christian or a crescent if he's a Muslim. And he's brandishing this and he's bashing somebody over the head with it. And as he does so, he shouts, with each blow, he shouts, "Infidel, blasphemer, homosexual, uppity woman, abortionist." And finally, the person being bashed over the head gets rather exasperated and takes the religious symbol and makes as if to break it over her knee, at which the cleric says, "Hey, hey, hey, respect." And that, I think, absolutely sums up The person who drew that cartoon would be delighted. That rather sums up the rhetorical position today. What one must understand is this, that there are charges on both sides of the debate about not understanding the other person's point of view. People of a religious commitment say this about those who don't share their views. They say, you don't understand our position, what it's like to have a commitment, what it means to us. And that's an odd thing for them to say, because of course the great majority of people who are not religious used to be and have become non-religious because they've given up the commitment that they were led into as children, taught at school, taught by their community, church, mosque, temple, synagogue. They've given it up sometimes with a great deal of difficulty and pain, but they understand very well what was involved and what the story is that their opponents in the discussion are committed to. But people on the religious side of the debate don't really quite see always what the point is, those who oppose them. And that's what I'd like very, very briefly to explain. Because in fact, there are three quite separate issues here, although they naturally connect with one another. There is the question of the metaphysical nature of the universe, what kinds of things there are in the universe. People who are religious, almost all of them anyway, think that there are supernatural agencies of some kind in the universe. Gods, goddesses, angels and archangels, demons, devils. And people who don't share that view are called by religious people atheists. That's a religious term used to describe people who don't share the metaphysics of the religious. Now, I'd much rather call myself an a-fairyist, or an a-goblinist, or an a-pixiest, and so on, for all the things that I don't believe exist. But if I were to call myself an a-fairyist or an a-pixiest, it would move me onto the ground of those people who believe in fairies and pixies, as if that was a discussion worth having. My point is that I don't think that there are supernatural agencies in the world on very, very good and considered grounds. Remember that what we take to be the case in the universe has to be proportional to the evidence that we have for it. And in this metaphysical question of what kind of place the universe is, there are very few grounds indeed for thinking that there is anything other than what natural laws reveal to us in all the beauty and excellence of the universe. The second thing, and this really is where the debate takes off, is secularism. And you don't have to be an a-fairyist or an a-pixiest to be a secularist. You might be a religious secularist. Secularist is somebody who believes that questions of public policy, questions of the complex pluralistic society we live in, should not be under the government of any one religion or indeed of the religions working in committee. Secularism is about the place of religious faith in the public square. And what a reasonable secularist thinks and should think is this, that religion and religious organizations has every right to exist and every right to have its say. But it has no greater right than any other self-constituted, self-elected interest group in society. A church is like a trade union or a political party or the Women's Institute or the Boy Scouts. It is instituted itself and it's there to put a point of view, entitled to do so. But as it happens all through history, still in our own country today and in many places in the world, religious organizations have a very privileged place in society. They have an amplified voice, much greater than the voice of other organizations in society, with the exception of political parties that succeed in getting their candidates into the legislature. And that I think, is where a good deal of the acerbity enters the debate. I'll give you an example. As you know, President Obama is trying to get some legislation through Congress in Washington at the moment to have a national health care insurance scheme. Just very recently, in the last few days, the Roman Catholic Church, which is a very powerful lobby in the United States, has succeeded in getting a clause accepted by the House of Representatives, which provides that nobody will benefit from this national health insurance scheme in order to get a termination of pregnancy, to get an abortion. It's just one very small example. One could cite many, many examples across many societies. For example, Taliban-governed areas of Afghanistan where women and girls are not allowed education or access to healthcare and the like, where, thank you, it says speak up, I'm sorry if you can't hear me, where access to social goods of various kinds are denied because of questions of dogma, because of particular religious outlook doesn't favour that way of doing things or thinking about things. And when religious organisations have that impact on the lives of individuals in society, denying women their rightful place in education, denying the opportunity for people to make choices about what happens in their personal lives, where there is too much interference in the public square. And remember, in our own country, we have an established religion which allows representatives of the established church to sit in the legislature and to vote on laws that affect us all. Richard Harries very kindly once had me to lunch in the House of Lords and woke me up to the fact that it's not only the current bishops who can sit in the House of Lords, but a number of former bishops, like Richard himself, who have become life peers. And they have an influence on the laws that are passed in our country. And it's that raises hackles and which makes the discussion of these matters sometimes a pretty robust one. So I mentioned atheism, mentioned secularism there, and finally there is an aspect of the debate which is more or less left out of account altogether. And that is that people who don't have a religious commitment are very often humanist in their outlook, in their ethics. And humanism is a view about the good for human individuals and the good for society, which tries to premise itself on our very best understanding of human nature and the human condition, of how things are for human beings. And it tries to erect a structure of ethical concern between individuals, urging the importance of good relationships between people, respect between human individuals on the basis of their human individuality, not on the basis of some identity that they choose for themselves, in the hope of trying to make this a collegial, cooperative, and flourishing world. That aspect of the debate is suppressed because the churches, the religious bodies, arrogate to themselves the claim that only they really have the right view about ethics, about the right way to live. So I would argue that given the fact that to be a non-believer is to stand in a relation to religion in the same way as the non-stamp collector stands to the stamp collector, that is, you just simply don't share that view, it's extremely hard indeed to be a fundamentalist non-stamp collector. You just don't take that particular view, and the fact that you don't says nothing else about what you believe and how you behave. Thank you very much.
And now I'm going to ask Charles Moore, former editor of the Daily Telegraph, very regular columnist now, and Charles is going to be speaking for the motion.
Sorry, I'll just put this water down because there's no flat surface. Thank you, Richard. And I'm sorry about this, the sound. Can you hear me? Because I know there's a problem with the rain, but as a Christian, I can't complain. It says in the Bible, the rain, it raineth on the just and the unjust. So that's appropriate tonight. There is a certain absurdity, I think, in all these debates on this subject, because great minds have wrestled with them throughout history. Milton wrote Paradise Lost, which is the greatest long poem in the English language, to justify, to assert eternal providence and justify the ways of God to men. And obviously, I and not even the bishop are capable of doing that very effectively tonight. But one of the strange things about our opponents, I think, is that they don't see the difficulty of this subject. To them, the truth is evident, and God and religion are evidently untrue. I think that what they think they're doing is they're shining a clear light of reason on the subject. But I would say that the light that they're casting is rather like the searchlight that the guards use in one of those war films. It sweeps wildly across the sky, and sometimes pointing vainly upwards, sometimes rushing past its intended target, and sometimes almost by chance, fixing upon the poor prisoners trying to escape to freedom. And standing behind its pitiless beam, Commandant Dawkins orders the victims to be gunned down. Our opponents tonight claim to speak for atheism. They speak with anger and with certainty. All those of us who were against fundamentalism should unite against their cause. In 1941, Albert Einstein wrote a letter to a friend. He was absolutely fed up, he said, with being barked at by numerous dogs who were earning their food guarding ignorance and superstition. Those were the religious fanatics. But then he went on, there are the fanatical atheists whose intolerance is of the same kind as the intolerance of the religious fanatics and comes from the same source. They are creatures who, in their grudge against the traditional opium of the people, cannot bear the music of the spheres. The great unbelieving scientist understood something very important about the temper of the fundamentalist mind. What is it that we find so distasteful about fundamentalists? It's not that they believe something passionately, that can be a good thing. It's not even that they're stupid, some of them are very clever. Surely what we find so unattractive about fundamentalism is the attitude that it discloses to the truth and to other people. First, to the truth. Instead of the truth being something which expands the mind, fundamentalists turn it into a harsh and narrow test to which humanity is forced to submit. Natural selection explains the whole of life, proclaims Richard Dawkins, and whatever else is said is wrong. In societies where fundamentalists gain power, such as modern Iran or Lenin's Russia, such narrow ideas of truth are imposed and brutally policed. Second, the attitude to other people. The fundamentalist attitude to those who do not accept his truth is at best pitying and at worst murderous. He thinks such people must be defective, they must be stupid or deluded. Richard's book is called The God Delusion, or evil. Professor Dawkins sees the whole debate as a whodunit, some gigantic game of Cluedo. And he thinks he knows who is guilty. It was the Reverend Green who did it, with the Bible in the nursery. And he wishes to punish him. For the fundamentalists, there can be nothing to be learnt from those with whom one disagrees. And this makes these debates so terribly sterile. And when I read The God Delusion, for example, I find many arguments very well put, exposing many fallacies. But I never, ever find any sense of mental quest. I find hard intelligence, yes, but no subtlety, no imagination about other ways of thought, no humility. The author writes with pride, and it's the pride of a boxer who thinks he's knocked somebody out. It's part of our opponent's fundamentalist position that they don't really distinguish between fundamentalism and other forms of religious belief. Just as followers of bin Laden will say that all infidels are damned, so these hyper-atheists say that all religion is equally contemptible. It seems to me that's like saying that fascists and liberals are really the same because both of them believe in politics. It's a grotesque parody of religious thought. And they attack a particular form of literalism which grew up in response to scientific attack in the 19th century, and they seem entirely unaware that literalism was confronted, for example, by St. Augustine, who did not believe that the world was created in 6 days, nearly 1,500 years earlier. So tonight, I'm not trying to prove the truth of Christianity or the existence of God, though I believe in them. It's not in my power to do that. But I'm asking us to turn away from fundamentalism and search for truth instead. It seems to me that the fundamentalist atheist assumes his superiority in advance, just like Calvinists who believe that they are one of the elect. He speaks from a lofty eminence. In an extraordinary passage in his book, Professor Dawkins points out that members of Mensa, the society of people with a high IQ, tend to be atheists. He also says that there are few atheists in prison. Therefore, he thinks, atheists are better, brighter people than believers. Like a clever schoolboy, he thinks that only brain power matters. Well, there are plenty of examples of brain power being put to bad use. What Winston Churchill famously called the lights of perverted science have beamed with a particularly ghastly brightness in modern times. I expect that Dr. Mengele, who conducted live experiments on children for the Nazis, was a man of very high IQ. But that's not my main point. My main point here is that Professor Dawkins' attitude to the life of the mind is one of conquest. He quotes approvingly the view that most scientists are bored by what they have already discovered. Most scientists are bored by what they have already discovered. Like Alexander the Great with territory or Rupert Murdoch with media outlets, they're always grabbing more. And he thinks that's good. But surely this is a bad set of attitudes. Far be it from me to disparage brain power. I thank God, literally, I thank God, for the achievements of science and for all other intellectual achievements. But is it really the case that human beings are less valuable because they are stupid or ill-educated or poor or sick or disabled? The African peasant woman who sacrifices herself to save her starving child stands higher, in some important sense, even than the president of the Royal Society, though I have no objection to that distinguished gentleman. The prisoner, whose faith Professor Dawkins looks down on with such disdain, understands something about the human predicament which is denied to those who worship only success. It's a unique feature of serious religion that it appeals both to some of the best minds who have ever lived and to the most unfortunate people in the world. It is also often very clearly grasped, and this is something which Professor Dawkins really hates, by children. Now, why? Why do the great religions, especially Christianity, put such store by the poor and the weak, the very young and the very old? I think it is because we can see what Cardinal Newman called the greatness and the littleness of man. We see the huge human capacity for achievement, invention, heroism, beauty, and love, juxtaposed sometimes in the very same human beings with cruelty, vanity, hatred, greed, and violence. And we're therefore profoundly unconvinced by explanations which are reductive and self-aggrandizing. We know that a world run by members of Mensa would not be a better place. And instead, we are attracted by paradox. We recognize truth in sentences which say that only when you are poor can you be rich, only when you are weak can you be strong, only when you die can you live. We do not abandon the power of reason, but we are aware of the ineradicable incongruity of our existence. As I say, our greatness and our littleness. So how could we be bored by what we have already discovered? We're fascinated by it. We can never stop reflecting on life's beauty and happiness, sadness and strangeness. And this means that we embrace forms of thought and communication which fundamentalists deride. When Professor Dawkins sees two pieces of wood traversing one another at right angles, perhaps he sees only a plus sign, or perhaps only the wood. But a Christian cannot see the plain wood, this plain wood, without thinking of the cross on which Jesus suffered and died. And as he surveys that cross, or holds it, he will remember his belief that from death on that cross came the conquest of death. So for us, the whole world, in its most daily occurrences, in bread or wine or a piece of wood, is charged with the deepest meaning. And we rediscover that every day. So what we are saying to Professor Dawkins and Professor Grayling and all the rest of these fundamentalists tonight is what Hamlet says to Horatio: there are more things in heaven and earth than are dreamt of in your philosophy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're on to Richard Dawkins now. Richard Dawkins, author of God Delusion, amongst many other books, and is himself, yes, an atheist. Thank you.
The rain, it raineth every day upon the just and unjust fella, but more upon the just, because the unjust hath the just's umbrella. Not my own. Hasten to say, not my own. Fundamentalism means different things to different people, but I think there are two elements that are common. First is blind obedience to a holy book, regardless of evidence. And this is what Richard Harris meant by impervious to facts. And the second is extremism. There is no holy book of atheism, and never could be. Atheism is not a belief system. There's no catechism of atheism, no 39 articles, no Torah, no Quran. There is no book, only publicly verifiable evidence. And that's anything but fundamentalist, because it contains a commitment to change as new evidence comes in. One of the many lies told about us is that we are dogmatically certain that we know the truth, know everything that is to be known. I think this is what Richard Harris meant by don't allow the grand perhaps. On the contrary, we glory in what we don't yet know. And that's the meaning of the quotation that Charles Moore attributed to me. It's actually Matt Ridley, my friend Matt Ridley, probably his friend Matt Ridley as well, who said that he was bored by what we already know. It's not really that we're bored by what we already know, but we're so excited by what it leads on to, which is what we don't know. We want to roll up our sleeves and get down to knowing more. And that, of course, is the real significance for a scientist of the gaps in our knowledge. To a religious person, a gap in our knowledge is likely to signify something that God did. You don't need to ask questions anymore because God simply did it. We, however, admit with some excitement that there are gaps in our knowledge, gaps waiting to be filled. Gaps do not provide a license to fill them with any old stuff that we happen to make up. And most certainly, they don't provide a license for any old stuff that happened to be made up by a tribe of ignorant desert nomads and just happened to get into some holy book or other. Science may not know what happened before the Big Bang. Science may not know yet how life began. But if science doesn't know the answer to those questions, then there's absolutely no reason to suppose that the answer is to be found in an ancient book or any religious text. To believe that would be true fundamentalism. In fact, if we're going to throw around accusations of dogmatic over-certainty, the boot is on the other foot with a vengeance. Even nice middle-of-the-road vicars and bishops are profligate with their certainties. They'll go into the pulpit and tell the congregation, God wants us to do X. God doesn't want us to do Y. How do you know? When did you ever hear a priest say, I think the balance of probability suggests that God wants X? When did you ever hear from a pulpit, we're waiting for further evidence? It's worth recalling that Doubting Thomas, the patron saint of scientists, was criticized for demanding evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. The other disciples were explicitly praised for accepting an alleged fact on faith in the absence of evidence. Let me turn now to the second meaning of fundamentalism, extremism. We are accused of being extremists. We new atheists are said to be no better than the Muslim extremists who hijack planes and fly them into buildings, or than the fundamentalist Christians who blow up abortion clinics. When was the last time you read of anybody who blew up anything in the name of atheism? Not blew something up and happened to be an atheist, blew something up in the name of atheism. The 19 hijackers of 9/11 did what they did in the name of their religion. They honestly and sincerely believed they were behaving in a good and righteous fashion. They believed they were doing what their God wanted them to do. They believed that they were going to a martyr's reward. They believed it because it followed logically from what they had been taught in their faith schools. Atheism doesn't have any faith schools. If we did, by the way, we wouldn't teach them atheism, we'd teach them critical thinking. and how to make up their own minds. And you can be absolutely sure that we would not teach them to employ violence, and certainly not suicide attacks. There is no logical pathway leading from atheism to violence. There most certainly are logical pathways leading from religion to violence. Now, of course, not many religious individuals follow those pathways to their logical conclusion, thank goodness. But there is a logical pathway from the Quran, for example, and it only takes a minority to be lured down it. For atheists, there is no such logical pathway. The nearest we get to violence is in the words we use. And there's a big difference. It's a grave misuse of the word extremism to say that atheists are just as extreme as religious extremists. As Victor Stenger, the physicist, has pithily put it in a slogan that might look well on the side of a bus, perhaps. Science flies you to the moon, religion flies you into buildings. Nevertheless, atheists such as me have been accused of using the language of extremism. We are strident, shrill, intolerant, aggressive, arrogant. We worship the mind rather than the soul, rather than the heart, rather than the gut, perhaps one might say, to parody Charles Moore. And we are accused of giving offence. Well, I think a great deal of this stems simply from the fact that religion has for so long been feather-bedded. Our whole society, the non-religious as well as religious portions of it, has bought into the fiction that it's somehow bad manners to criticize religion. Douglas Adams put it beautifully in an impromptu speech in Cambridge in 1998. Religion has certain ideas at the heart of it which we call sacred or holy or whatever. What it means is, here is an idea or a notion that you're not allowed to say anything bad about. You're just not. Why not? Because you're not. Why should it be that it's perfectly legitimate to support the Labour Party or the Conservative Party, Republicans or Democrats, this model of economics versus that, Macintosh instead of Windows? But to have an opinion about how the universe began, about who created the universe, no, that's holy. We're used to not challenging religious ideas. But it's very interesting how much of a furore Richard creates when he does it. Everybody gets absolutely frantic about it because you're not allowed to say these things. So when somebody like me says something even mildly critical of religion, it is heard as strident and aggressive, even if it's actually less so than would be perfectly acceptable if it were anything other than religion that was being criticized. There's nothing really new about the so-called new atheists. Nothing new in what we say. The only thing new about us is that we speak up and we call a spade a spade. This is not fundamentalism, it's just honest clarity of expression. We use our brains rather than our gut. New atheism speaks clearly. This used not to happen. Atheists were supposed to know their place, to shut up and respect automatically religious faith. I love a quotation from Johann Hari who said, "I respect you too much to respect your ridiculous ideas." So entrenched is the assumption, implicitly accepted for centuries by religious and non-religious alike, that religion must automatically be respected, that even clarity is heard as offensive, as fundamentalist indeed. I'm confident that this audience will not be swayed by such pussyfootery and will vote with their heads instead of with their guts. Vote against this motion. Thank you.
And it would be helpful, obviously, to have the house lights up, and so I can see where the questioners are. There's a question here. It could be a lady, could be a gentleman, certainly a human being. Could be an atheist, could be an agnostic, and off we go.
In Portlock, and I've got a question for both Professor Dawkins and Grayling. And I'd like to start first off by praising Professor Dawkins, saying...
OK, I'm going to be a fascist, whether a liberal fascist or not, and just ask, could we, with so many questions, can we just get straight to the question?
Let's cut to the quick. Professor Dawkins says that atheism has no catechism. Well, now, I'm a disabled person, and as a disabled person, I have quite strong feelings about the issue of assisted suicide. I'm basically opposed to it. I looked at the British Humanist Association website, and they not only are in favour of assisted suicide, but have, as Richard Herries will know, stigmatised those who also, like me, are opposed to assisted suicide, portraying us as selfish.
The question being...
Richard Dawkins has stated in online, there's a quote from Richard Dawkins about how if he reaches a certain state of health, he would like to be put down. Christopher Hitchens has made a few not very sensitive use of disability language. I can't comment on AC grading. My contention is that for the new atheists, the rejection of the idea of that life is to be preserved in most cases is as much a statement of dogma as the Holy Trinity is to Christians.
Thank you very much for that question. Second question, lady over here. And do we have a microphone on the third question? No, because there are a lot of questions over here. We have a third question. Second question, please. Lady in red.
This is a quotation from Robert Halliday, a professor of philosophy at Syracuse University. It is, if the gods or God love justice because it is right, then rightness of justice is prior to God's loving it. God is not the source of the rightness of justice, but commands it because it is already right. God is therefore not necessary for a moral order in the universe. Would you please discuss?
I love discussion. We are a school after all, but I'm even keener on precise questions. Let's have the third question over here, please.
Hello. I am interested. There can be fundamentalists on both sides, it seems to me. It's very easy to pick out people who are fundamentalists. The argument that Richard Dawkins was putting, which was that you cannot have a fundamentalist on the atheist side, is it not a fundamentalist position to say there is no God?
Thank you for that short question. Chris, and I think let's begin with Richard on that.
I will begin, if I may.
We've got lots of Richards up here. Thank you. Richard. One. Please go.
I will just respond to the second question, if I may, by saying, Of course, all human beings can have a sense of justice, whether they're believers or not. And that is actually fundamental to a classical Christian view, because we believe that all human beings have been made in the image of God, and part of that is a capacity for discerning what is right and wrong. What happens if, in the light of our sense of justice, we come to believe that God is good, all good, our true and everlasting God, good, obviously that shapes and colours our whole sense of what it is to be just.
Thank you for that. Richard Dawkins.
The first question, am I audible? I'll answer the first question on assisted suicide. I think it's a simple matter of individual freedom. If you don't want to go on living, who are society to stop you ceasing your life in a humane way? There's an additional point to this, which is that there are some people, and I know of at least one personally, who have committed suicide themselves long before they needed to or even strictly wanted to, because they wanted to do it while they were still in command of their faculties. And if they had known that when the time later came and they were no longer in command, sufficiently in command of their faculties to do the deed themselves, there would be a doctor to help them. So if you allow assisted suicide, you might actually end up getting fewer suicides, or at least later suicides.
And then a quick response from, first of all, Charles Moore.
I want to pick up the question about, is it fundamentalist to say that there is no God? Did you notice that atheist bus campaign that they had on the side? It said, there's probably no God. And the reason they said that, I think, is they realised they were in a bit of a muddle about this, because they could only truthfully say, according to their own position, that there's probably no God, because if they said there is no God, they would be making a statement of faith, and of course they feel they mustn't do that. So they were actually in a bit of a muddle about what on earth they were talking about.
Richard's not in a muddle.
What could be more fundamentalist than saying there is definitely no God? We demonstrated our lack of fundamentalism by saying the proper scientific thing, there's probably no God.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Anthony one second. So, Richard, does that mean there may be a God, logically?
There may be a leprechaun.
Yes.
No, that's, you can't let Richard get away with that. That's a ridiculous remark. No. That is a ridiculous remark.
Okay,
you cannot confuse the God of classical theism, which has animated the whole of Western philosophy, with a leprechaun, and I'm surprised at you.
Anthony says you can.
Look, firstly, with great respect to Charles Moore, it's he who's rather confused about the atheist bus. But we did want to say there is no God on the bus, and it turned out that the Advertising Standards Authority required of us that we insert a probably there, despite the fact that the very many theist adverts on buses say things like Jesus saves and so on, rather unequivocally. But may I just point out something? Richard's remark about the leprechaun does remind me of the old Irish lady who was asked if she believed in leprechauns, and she said, "I do not, but they're there anyway." And I have to remind Richard Harries that he is an atheist, and I would be quite unequivocal about the gods of Olympus, Aphrodite, Ares, and the rest.
The Norse gods, probably. And the first Christians were called atheists.
They were indeed, because
this is a debate, you know. I mean, I was going to ask Anthony, if you saw a leprechaun, what would you then say?
I would try to imitate an Irish accent and say, "Hello."
Well, that's quite a good try. I guess we're going to go over here to a question.
Could I ask Commandant Dawkins to comment on how he feels being characterised as the guard in Charles Moore's analogy, I think, when in fact we know that it's religious people over the centuries who've tried to be the guardians of our morals, deciding on when we can trade on a Sunday, whether we can have abortions, and when we eat fish.
So how do you feel about that one? Just stay that away for one moment. Question number two over here. Yes, please.
Hi, good evening. I just wanted to make a point about some schools that study religion from an evolutionary point of view. They think that the evolution is an adaptation that provides intergroup cooperation. If we extend the meaning of religion from its etymology, which bonds together under the same law, could we extend the word religion to other behaviors such as atheism if pushed too far?
Okay, intriguing. Gentleman over there waving radically.
Yeah, question for Richard Dawkins. You often label the most famous atheist in the world, and I was just wondering if you were proud of that title.
Are you proud? There you are. Good, we're going to take those questions. 1, 2, 3. Richard D, starting with you.
Well, the first question about Commandant, whether it was the guard, I think the questioner answered his own question, and I agree with the answer that he gave. I didn't actually understand the second question, so I'll leave that to somebody else. And the third question, am I proud? No, I'm certainly not proud. I may have some of the seven deadly sins, but that's not one of them.
Would you be proud, Richard, if in 2,000 years there were Dawkins atheist churches across the world?
No, I would hope it didn't come to that. I would like my books to be still read. Okay. As Hilaire Belloc said, his sins were scarlet, but his books were red.
Very good. Scarlet sins, red books. Let's hear from the theist side. On the second question, or anyone.
I think those questions are really all directed to Richard.
Okay, and there was the middle question, which we're just going to float in the air. Can I just get one in from Twitter, which is that Charles Moore has got it wrong, apparently, says an anonymous person on Twitter. Atheists don't think we are any better. The main point is we don't like religion getting a disproportionate say. I suppose the question is there, does religion get a disproportionate say? Do you have any comment on that?
I think that one of the good things about modern times is, and it goes back to early Christianity, and in this way I have no objection to Dawkins, Grayling and the rest of it, is that we have come under attack. That was part of the profound understanding of Christians about what is likely to happen to you in the world. And it's perfectly true, and all the atheists here, I agree with them if they say this, that when Christianity takes political power, it's very bad for Christianity and very bad for everybody else.
Okay, thank you for that. Question one over here, please. Darren, yes?
Hi. From your side, it seemed that your opposition to them is that they rule out your position, as is in your belief. But do you think Dawkins, Hitchens, Harris are having a negative impact on society? And if so, can you justify that? By that, I mean with their science, their skepticism, their humanism, secularism. Can you say if you think that's a negative impact?
Are they making a better world? Are you making a worse world? Question two over there. Someone at the back. Thank you.
Mr. Dawkins, it's been said by famous scientists that if the world was not created how it was, the universe was not created how it was, human beings as they were would not be here today. Do you not think that some sort of supernatural force is in place here? Thank you.
Can I just say that we are, questions from ladies are welcome. We are a co-ed school. We made an extraordinary observation in the school that the world is co-ed. Question, yes.
Hello, I'm very much an atheist myself, but I want to know about Richard Dawkins' beliefs. Does Richard Dawkins believe that Christianity and other religions have had an enormously beneficial effect on society and on individuals for thousands of years, and that when a vicar stands up in church and says he believes God's telling us, he's using it as a metaphor to teach people how to behave well in society? Does he believe those things? Because if not, then I think he is a fundamentalist.
Okay, let's just begin over here then. On balance, even though I've worked out that you guys don't believe in God, do you think that the world, on balance, is better for 2,000 years of Christianity and 4,000 years of Buddhism and Hinduism?
Well, I take it that the great classical tradition, which lasted right up until about the 4th century AD, nearly 1,000 years, and from which Christianity gets most of its ethics. I mean, you have to remember that the ethics of the New Testament, which says, give away all your money, don't take any thought for the morrow, repudiate your family if they don't agree with you, is pretty well unlivable, other than by monks and nuns. And that it was so because, of course, they thought the end of the world was just about to come. And when after a couple of centuries, they were, you know, looking at the watch, and they thought, well, we better have slightly richer ethical resources than just those, because they're not very practical. And so they borrowed them wholesale from the classical tradition, mainly from Stoicism. I can give you a seminar on this if you're prepared to wait afterwards. And that most of what we think of as the ethical benefit comes from that source, from the classical source. Richard Harris mentioned the great art and music which has been inspired by Christianity. And that phrase, that inspired by Christianity, I'm certain is true for people like Bach and many others who really were inspired by their faith. But I'm also sure that most artists and composers were, like the rest of us, people who had to eat. And the church was the major commissioning agent at the time. And that may explain why there are so many Madonnas.
Richard, on balance, and a yes or no answer here, would the last 2,000 years have been better in Western civilization with no Christianity?
Yes.
That was a yes.
I'd like to take up one of the other questions I made, where I think the question was whether the new atheism has having a negative impact on society. I think that was the question that I picked, and I would actually, funnily enough, say I don't think it is, because for too long religion has claimed the moral high ground, and I think the new atheism, in attacking religion from a moral standpoint, is quite right to do so, because there's a very great deal of bad religion around and they're right to criticize it. But they've slipped into this new intellectual fundamentalism by claiming the intellectual high ground. They now call themselves the Brights. And once when I tackled Anthony Grayling with that, he looked a bit sheepish, as though he'd been rumbled. Yes, he did think himself one of the new breed of the Brights.
And talking about bright, do you remember your voting slip here? The bright red for four and the plain white against. Just bear that in mind. We're going to take a question. Or do anyone want to come back on any of those, the last three? Done. Let's take a question at the back, please.
There's a lady here.
There's a lady. Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you very much.
Hello. How can you advocate the fact that my child could have an entirely different education to their neighbour just because they've gone to a faith school? And how can you ethically advocate that I will be governed by laws that I don't believe in because I'm a secular humanist?
Thank you for that. Second question at the back and the third one down here.
Good evening. In September this year, the Catholic Church published a report to the United Nations, and in that report they said that only 1.5% to 5% of Catholic clergy are engaged in child abuse. Would the panel speculate how they think that percentage works for other churches or on the atheist side of the line?
Thank you very much. Child abuse, question over here, please. The person with the microphone, yep.
I have a question for Charles Moore and Richard Harries. Do you think that if your subtle, scholarly, nuanced brand of religion was the norm, Richard Dawkins and A.C. Grayling wouldn't have had to write their books? The point is, I attended a lecture at a top British university last year given by the head of Answers in Genesis, Ken Ham, who was not only preaching scientific ignorance, he was also preaching right-wing bigotry from the grave of Jerry Falwell. Why shouldn't we get angry about that?
Okay. I'm going to ask the side to come in first on those.
Can I just say on that...
Can you speak to the microphone?
I don't believe that I was arguing for a subtle and nuanced brand of Christianity. I think I was simply arguing for a mainstream traditional form of Christianity. And, of course, you're right to attack people like the person you mentioned. But I don't think we should allow ourselves to be marginalised by thinking we're a sort of clever, super-modern version of Christianity that's being put forward, at least by me. This is just what has been put forward by mainstream churches throughout history. And one of the things that I think is quite wrong about the Dawkins-Grayling argument is to characterise... It's the other way around from what you're saying. They're taking people like mad creationists and they're trying to project that onto the whole of the Christian faith for 2,000 years. That seems to me a total misrepresentation.
Richard?
I think we need to emphasise, of course, there's a very great deal of bad religion around, and bigotry, wherever it appears, needs to be attacked. But the debate tonight is not about bad religion. It's a question of whether the new atheism has slipped into a kind of fundamentalism. That is what the debate is about. Atheism, faced with certain forms of religion, is a kind of purification, is a necessary purification. And I made it clear at the beginning there are many forms of atheism I deeply respect.
If God did exist, how come he's letting Richard Dawkins and Anthony Grayling say what they are saying?
I think to help us all to think.
Good. Help us to think, both of you.
On this question, which the questioner raised about the good and the bad kinds of religion, I think he's absolutely right. It would be marvellous if all religious people were like our two panellists here tonight. And it may be right that deserves the title mainstream in some historical periods, but I rather doubt that. But the fact is, it doesn't today. And if you go to the United States, as I often do, the huge majority of religious people are just the kind of religious people you don't want. And that's the reason why I found it necessary to write The God Delusion. The questioner is absolutely right. There would have been no need if everybody was like Charles Moore and Richard Harries. But unfortunately, they're not. To pick up on the Cluedo jibe that Charles Moore raised, that the Reverend Green did it. In America, he's not even called the Reverend Green. He's called Mr. Green. He's not allowed to be called the Reverend Green because in America it's inconceivable that a clergyman could possibly do anything wrong.
Anthony.
I mean, just to revert to the rhetorical point about the name-calling which is going on, fundamentalist atheists and so on, the truth of the matter is that people who are troubled by the criticisms levelled at them really do set the bar very, very low indeed as to what they will accept in the way of criticism. So if they're spoken to rather robustly, you know, people who criticise religion are said to be intolerant of religion, as though a physicist who doesn't believe in magic is intolerant of magic. It's an attempt to try to displace the criticism by attacking the criticiser. I mean, one thing that was very noticeable about Charles Moore's contribution this evening was that it was very largely an ad hominem attack on Richard Dawkins, not really an attack on the ideas.
Anthony, have you ever had a religious experience?
No, but the nearest thing that I ever came to it was when I fell in love with my wife.
And she's here tonight. I think that certainly deserves a round of applause. Charles and Richard, have you ever had an atheistic experience, just for...
Yes, of course, because it's a phase that you go through when you're a teenager.
Ah, OK. Wow. OK. We're going to have a question. There's a lot of questions over here. I'm very keen to get some questions down over on this side here, but a gentleman here first. Good. And then over here, please. Yep.
Professor Dawkins, you are arguably the world's leading apologist for atheism. And you have been invited on several occasions by arguably the world's leading Christian academic apologist, Dr. William Lane Craig, to engage in debate. I would like to know why this is not an example of the new atheist doing what Lord Harries has described as avoiding the strongest possible arguments from the opposition.
Okay,
thank you.
That's a very straight question. Over here now and then at the back, please. Let's take question number two at the back, please. Yep.
Atheist fundamentalism is not a new phenomenon. If Professor Dawkins had read history of Russia and China, he would know that atheism conducted programs of violence against people of faith. Have you a comment to make on that, please, Professor?
That's a monstrous suggestion.
That's a monstrous suggestion, but we're going to hold back in just a second, and the monster will just be suppressed while we have the third question over here.
Professor Grayling talked about the many strands of unbelief, and Charles Moore talked about the subtleties of Christianity, and I wonder whether Mr. Moore would like to comment on the idea that there's not much subtlety in calling everybody that's an unbeliever an atheist.
Okay, we'll take Richard first on why you're not apparently prepared to debate against that lady, then we'll come over here and we'll finish up on the question there about Stalin's gulags.
I have always said when invited to do debates that I will be happy to debate a bishop, a cardinal, a pope, an archbishop, indeed I have done both, but that I don't take on creationists and I don't take on people whose only claim to fame is that they are professional debaters. They've got to have something more than that. I'm busy.
And if she said she was busy too, you would say?
It was a he, actually. But
oh my goodness, what a boob. Over here, moving straight on, yeah.
What do you want me to, which one?
I'd like you to come back on that second question, if you can recall it.
No.
Charles.
Well, I think the lady over there was asking a question about how did I describe unbelievers. I certainly wouldn't describe all people who don't believe as atheists. Obviously not, and nor would I just treat all atheists in the same way. The point of this argument tonight is about a particular character of atheism which has decided to assail Christianity without trying to, faith more broadly, without, I think, honestly trying to understand what it is, and it's that to which I'm objecting.
Thank you very much. And now the response on Russia, Richard.
The implication was made that the monstrosity, the awfulness of Stalin's Russia, Mao's China, had something to do with atheism. These were dreadful people having dreadful political philosophy which they ruthlessly enforced in their countries. It is incidentally true that they happen to be atheists. It's incidentally true that Hitler, Stalin and Saddam Hussein all had moustaches, but it's nothing to do with either their moustaches or, in the case of Stalin, his atheism. Hitler wasn't an atheist.
Okay, serious point here, Richard. What would then be your response to somebody who would say that Muhammad Atta and his 18 colleagues on 9/11 had nothing to do truly with spirituality and with love of mankind?
It had everything to do with their Islamic religion. You know absolutely for sure, nobody heard it, but we all know what their last words were. They were motivated by religion from start to finish. We have their testimony to say so. There's absolutely no serious doubt that they were motivated by their Islamic faith to do that terrible deed that they did. I won't say that it's spiritual. You can easily say it's not my kind of religion. Of course it's not. But that's not the point. It was religion that did it. There's a logical pathway between religious belief and doing acts of hideous violence, in the way that there is no logical pathway between atheism and doing acts of hideous violence.
Okay, but yeah, but to be fair to the other side, Richard, many people who believe in religion believe that the very essence of religion is love for fellow man, and therefore acts of violence are antithetical to everything that they believe about in religion. What's your response to them? Are they also tricksy or mad or
not at
deluded?
All. I mean, the great majority of religious individuals are delightful people who would never hurt a fly. But the fact is that there is a logical pathway between religion and violence, and there's no logical pathway between atheism and violence.
It's very hot up here. I'm going to have Anthony and then I'm going to have Charles. Quick comment from Anthony, then Charles, please.
If love is the essence of religion, then most religions aren't religions, it turns out. Well, there is a very important point to be made about Stalin and Nazism. Stalinism, Nazism and Maoism, they share something in common with the great religions, and that is that they are monolithic ideologies that believe that they have the one great truth and everybody's got to sign up for it on pain of punishment if they don't agree. They are formally and structurally very similar to one another. It's no surprise to me that Stalin spent his formative years as a would-be priest in a seminary. He would have learned from that something, a very important historical lesson about the way that you indoctrinate a people with ideas and get them to sign up for the great project, and if they don't, then they're heterodox in some way and they're going to be punished for it. So it's not really so much a question whether it's a religion or a totalitarian ideology. It's the structure of that kind of thing. What I think we are wanting to argue on our side is that people should think for themselves, choose for themselves, do so responsibly, respect their fellow human beings as individual human beings, and try to live thoughtfully on the basis of the evidence.
Okay. I'm trying to get cross sections. We've got 10 minutes to go. I'd like somebody from the middle, towards the back on this column, someone from second left over here, and third, we've had no one from the middle in this column here yet. But while we're doing that, can I just, another Twitter, we're just absolutely covered in Twitter comments. And this one here, by attacking Richard Dawkins, you are making a martyr of him. Why on earth do you do it?
Well, I guess I do it because I was invited to do it by you, but... Contrary to what Anthony Grayling is saying, I'm not making an ad hominem attack on Richard Dawkins. I'm attacking what Richard Dawkins argues and writes, and that seems to me rather the subject of the day.
OK, and just one more Twitter. If the universe was created, I think you'd probably assume that it was, it would lack... was it lack of self-destructing intelligence, and isn't that proof for evolution? And I simply absolutely know, not a clue what that means, so let's move straight on over there, but I'm sure it's a very good question. Let's take a question over here, please. Yep, lady, yes, excellent, lady first.
How would you respond to a sign that I saw outside a what appeared to be sort of a mainstream church in the UK, in the south-east, saying... don't think, just believe.
Don't think, just believe. And one over here, yes, second questioner. And let's take the third question, go, yeah, gentleman here.
Could I ask each side to give an account of the criteria they use for assessing truth?
Okay.
And then to justify that against the charge of fundamentalism.
All right, and while we're doing this and the third question is doing it, can we please make certain that you cast your votes? The votes, please. Everyone clear about the votes? Hope so. Questioner here. Yes, please.
Richard Dawkins, as has already been said, you're quite happy with the atheist bus campaign wording. Yeah, after all, you endorsed it. It said, God probably doesn't exist. Now, I'm a bit sad. I brought a dictionary along with me, which suggests that someone of that point of view is an agnostic. Doesn't that mean that it's actually an agnostic bus campaign? You're actually agnostic, and you're probably not the best qualified person to oppose the motion tonight.
Excellent, excellent. Wonder what school you went to. Yes.
Hello?
Yep, and a questioner here. Please go ahead, gentleman in the aisle.
A question about the nature of consciousness. Do the four panellists believe that advances in science in recent years have either shown that it is either very likely or very unlikely that consciousness can exist either as a separate consciousness or as an irreducible facet of humanity, which is not reducible to materialism?
A question of infinite profundity about the nature of consciousness. And let's begin, I think, on this side, in fairness.
Well, we've had about six excellent questions, but criteria for truth, very briefly, the total human experience, not just what we might derive from science, but our experience of beauty, our experience of conscious, our experience of human relationships, all this we put together and wonder what the heck it's all about. So it's the total range of human experience.
Charles Moore, what are you going to pick up on?
I just wanted to say that I'm interested by the way these questions have gone, because it illustrates the problem we have with the whole of this debate, which is it's always a serious question that's impossible to answer. And indeed, when the serious question is raised, the chairman says, oh, that's very difficult, and let's go on to another one. And the trouble, and this is why I worry about the new the fundamentalist atheist, is because what it is using the method of scorn in order not to have the argument. It's always saying, you know, here's the ridiculous example, here's the reductio ad absurdum, here is the bad behaviour. Instead of trying to actually to address and talk about these questions that keep coming from so many people in the hall tonight and so many people all over the world who actually want to think about the answers.
Okay. Thank you very much. I don't, in fact, think, Charles, I don't quite accept that, because I think you have had every chance to come back and answer at length. You haven't always chosen to do so. Are there any other of the questions that were asked in that batch that you'd like to come back on?
I'm not complaining personally. I'm just, I haven't been persecuted. I fear that the whole discussion about these issues is constantly misrepresented by the form that it takes and by the type of argument that sometimes comes from the atheist fundamentalist.
Okay. Richard.
Earlier on, Richard made a wonderfully telling point, I thought, when he said he'd never heard from a pulpit the remark on the balance of probabilities. Well, I can honestly say, when I think I've read nearly all your books, I've never read the statement on the balance of probabilities there might not be a God.
What about the bus campaign?
No, I'll eat my words if you can point that.
Well, but I can.
They're so definite.
No, chapter 4 of The God Delusion is called Why There Almost Certainly Is No God. I have put forward a 7-point scale from 1 total certainty there is a God to 7 total certainty there is no God, and I place myself as a number 6.5.
chapter 4, verse 2, do you want to come back on that?
Well, that's not quite the same as the balance of probability. You know, it's almost certainly probable. It's not quite the same, the balance of probability.
Well, if by that you mean we should be saying 50%, I'm certainly not happy to go for 50%.
I think I've... You asked a very interesting earlier question about experience of atheism. I draw a distinction between intellectual atheism and experiential atheism. The kind of experience the poet Edwin Muir had once in a bus, when the human beings in front of him were suddenly stripped of any sense of being human. Now, I do think that is a totally devastating experience. You sometimes get it after a Samuel Beckett play. I mean, a wonderful playwright, but you suddenly feel human beings are being stripped of anything to do with the spirit. Now, actually, I think many religious believers go through that kind of experience of atheism, where the world suddenly seems totally devoid and empty of God. And it might have been that experience of Jesus on the cross, you know, when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I think that sense of experiential atheism is actually much more disturbing than intellectual atheism.
May I? Of course you may. Responding.
It is Sunday. We've heard a sermon. That's great. The implication of what Richard has just said is that to be an atheist is to have a dreary, bleak experience where everybody's stripped of their humanity. I can assure him it is utterly not like that at all. In fact, human beings come so fully into focus, their concern, their interest, their needs. That's why so many of us on this side of the debate are so committed to questions of human rights, civil liberties, campaign for them, promote the idea of free-minded education for children and equality for everybody in this world. And we do it because we don't think that the responsibility for that lies anywhere other than in our own hands. Now I'd like to answer the questions, if I may. Don't think, just believe. Yes, that's one of the explanations for the persistence of religion. It reminds me of my favourite joke from Bertrand Russell, who said, most people would rather die than think, and most people do. That explains that one. I've got been a challenge to explain my criteria for truth. Truth is a very, very hard thing to find except in local empirical circumstances. Much, much more significant than that is rationality. And the word rationality is a very interesting one. First part of it, ratio, is about proportioning evidence to the conclusions that you derive from them. It means being guided by your very best exploration of the evidence, your very best, most responsible reasonings, submitting things to public test and debate. Rationality is the key. To behave, to think, and to believe rationally on the basis of the evidence, that is the surest path towards truth. You have to remember what Voltaire said. I will defend with my life the person who is seeking the truth, but I will not be so keen on the person who claims to have it. Finally, there is one big difference between Richard Dawkins and myself on the question of the 6.5 and agnosticism. I am not one little bit agnostic about fairies or pixies or goblins and so on, for all the other supernatural agencies that might be invoked. Don't forget, by the way, that fairies were very, very widely believed in this country until pretty recently. And the Irish lady I talked about earlier was by no means alone in that respect. The reason why you couldn't find your shoelaces and so on was because the fairies had pinched them. And one reason why the Church of England, in its great benevolence, instituted primary school education in the 19th century was to extirpate that kind of superstition about fairy kind of belief. Now, I'm not an agnostic about that, and for exactly the same kind of rational, I hope, reasons, I'm not agnostic about deities and gods and goddesses and the rest of it. And finally, consciousness, very briefly. If you want to investigate the relationship of consciousness to matter, and in particular the brain, just take a heavy, blunt instrument and bash yourself over the head and see which bits of thinking you can no longer do.
It's a terrible struggle here to balance reasoned comments from our very distinguished panellists and about 100 hands that are up at the moment, and I'm failing terribly all the time to try and get that balance. Let's take a question over here. A lady with a red hand up, or someone with a mic. Power is all. Got a mic, go. Yes.
Hello. More a question to the two gentlemen who argue for the motion. I got the feeling that you're a little bit more aggressive and a little bit more on the defensive in this argument. And I just wonder, maybe you feel that religion, mainstream religion, is losing the argument and therefore you have to go a little bit more on the defensive. And perhaps religion, as it is, has lost its purpose at all in the way of explaining the world, okay, and the universe and binding society together. What do you feel about this?
And hold that, and we're going to take these in the sum-ups. Lady over there.
I'd just like to ask Richard Dawkins a straight question. He seemed to speak with some authority about what vicars are saying in their pulpits at churches. When were you last in a church?
And a questioner over here. Do we have someone with a microphone over here? Someone with a microphone, stand up. Go, anyone with a microphone. Off you go. Your moment has come. Let's go. Microphone, please stand up. Go. Ask. Yes. Please go. It's a question about silence. Yeah.
This is to Mr. Moore. You say the gram perhaps as if, like, we know, like, atheists know everything, even though atheists and scientists only have theories, and yet you have the Bible, and that is the word, and you fail to accept anything else than that.
Thank you for that. Now we're going to now have the sum-ups, and there's a premium here on doing it in 2 minutes each. I'm going to ask Richard Dawkins to begin by summing up everything you've heard and everything you want to say.
I suppose the two main issues that have come up are, first, the idea that we on this side are somehow bleak and empty, and the distinction that Richard Harris made about experiential atheism, the sense of despair which is supposed to afflict us when we lose faith. As Anthony Grayling has just said, it's nothing like that at all. On the contrary, it's a sense of release. It's a sense of freedom from an oppressive overlookedness. You somehow realize that you are free, you're in control of your own life. You are looking out at the universe. I think the chairman asked about, have you ever had a religious experience? I wouldn't call it a religious experience, but when I lie on my back and look up at the Milky Way on a clear night and see the vast distances of space and reflect that these are also vast differences of time as well, when I look at the Grand Canyon and see the strata going down, down, down through periods of time which the human mind can't comprehend, I'm overwhelmingly filled with a sense of almost worship. It is not worshipping anything personal any more than Einstein would have worshipped anything personal. It's a feeling of sort of abstract gratitude that I am alive to appreciate these wonders. When I look down a microscope, it's the same feeling. I'm grateful to be alive to appreciate these wonders. I know that I'm going to die and it's finite. All the more reason to appreciate it, to enjoy it, and to exult in it. Now, the other issue is the narrow one of the motion. Are we fundamentalist? I think it's probably fair to say that some of us are passionate, and that we are deeply passionate. We care deeply about, for example, the truth, which I would define as that which is supported by objectively discernible evidence. We're passionate, and we may be passionate about some of the moral issues that arise. They haven't come up much this evening, but moral issues that arise when religiously influential people interfere with the private lives of others. I feel very passionate about that. But please don't mistake passion for bigotry, for narrowness, for arrogance, for fundamentalism. You can be passionate without being fundamentalist. There really is an important difference. I'm happy, indeed proud, to be passionate. I'm happy to be passionate about the truth. I'm happy, I hope, to speak clearly, but none of that implies fundamentalism in the sense of extremism or in the sense of implacable devotion to some kind of holy book.
Richard, I let you run on there because you were briefer in your initial. Could I ask everyone just to keep ideally to 2 minutes in the sum-up comments, please?
I was very glad to hear what Richard Dawkins said just then, but I don't think that is the characteristic of his writing and preaching. And this is what we complain about with atheist fundamentalism, because though it's admitted that there may be a God, it's then immediately spoken all the time as if there couldn't possibly be one, and also no attempt is made to understand what religion is as it's understood by its adherents. Richard spoke eloquently of that sense of freedom. I do assure you that Christians believe that freedom. They experience that freedom. And I do assure you also that when they lie down and look at the Milky Way, they have comparable experiences. But I think that they have an experience which goes a bit deeper and goes a bit further about what they see. And that experience is summed up in the last line of perhaps the greatest poem ever written, Dante's Divine Comedy, when he speaks of the love which moves the sun and the other stars. And that is the case which we feel is consistently misrepresented, and the case which, if the atheist fundamentalists had the intellectual honesty which they say they did, they would listen to that with more respect rather than traducing it.
Thank you. AC Grayling summing up against the motion.
Well, Charles Moore reminds us, and I mentioned this in my opening comments, that a standard charge laid against people who don't have a religious outlook is that they don't understand the religious outlook, that we don't appreciate how it feels to be religious and to have that way of looking at things. And I pointed out that the great majority of people who don't have a religious outlook used to have one. Most atheists are people who have won through to an open-minded, free-thinking way of looking at the world from having been brought up in one or another religion, their parents' religion usually, and had it inculcated into them when they were very young. Of course, there is great evolutionary advantage for children to be extremely credulous. That's why children believe in Father Christmas, the Tooth Fairy, God, anything that the adults tell them with a serious expression on their faces. By the time they get to 11 or 12, they've lost their belief in Tooth Fairies and Father Christmas, but social reinforcement of religious belief is massive and pervasive, and that's why religious belief persists. So most people, almost everybody, more than 90% I would guess, do know what it's like to sit in church or synagogue or temple and to have be in that ambience. So we do understand it, and it may very well be that we understand it all too well. It's not that we don't understand it, we understand it all too well, which is why we disagree with it. That's point number one. And point number two, Charles and others say what we should try to make some sense of the inner meaning, the inner workings of a religious outlook. The problem is this, that religion, for somebody who is critical of its premises, is in the same sort of position as astrology. Now, astrology bases itself on the idea that what we can see from planet Earth in the way of heavenly bodies has an influence on our character and our destiny. Once you've come to the conclusion that that just ain't so, then there's no point in getting involved in all the complexities of the different astrological theories. Once you've come to the view that this is just an untenable position, no point in going into all the things that Charles Moore says we should get into in trying to understand that the internal feeling of that position. Fact is that rejecting a certain view, rejecting a certain way of looking at the world, entails nothing further other than a responsibility to begin to think carefully about what you do think and why, how you would make a good, responsible case for that, and how you would live responsibly and well in a world where it is our job as human beings to make the best fist we can of our endowment in nature.
AC Grayling, thank you very much indeed. And
I'd just take the opportunity, if I may, to address the last question, which was all asked from the audience, about whether Charles and myself are not really on the defensive on this issue now. And strangely, I think I would want to admit that, in a sense, we are, because on the one hand, we're battling against creationist religious fundamentalists, and on the other hand, against the new atheists. And I've suggested at the beginning the sense in which they feed each other. And it's therefore very, very difficult to get across the case for classical Christian thought in the Western tradition. And if I might say so, I think Anthony slipped into that again earlier on, where he put together not believing in fairies and not believing in what he called deities. But in that sense, the early Christians, as I said earlier, were atheists. They didn't believe in deities. They believed in the God of classical Western theism, who is not an existent in the world of existence, not a thing in the world of things, but the ground and goal of all existence, in whom all things exist. John of Damascus, in the 8th century, and no doubt I might be scorned for quoting somebody such a long time ago, but John of Damascus, in the 8th century, great bastion of Christian orthodoxy in the East, said, what God is in himself is totally incomprehensible and unknowable. And it's that sense of the mystery of God. We can use words about God and deity and deities, but in the end, we're talking about something which is beyond human words. And I think it's that sense of mystery which both religious fundamentalism and the new atheism somehow fail to point to in any way.
Thank you. And in just 10 words each, if God didn't create the universe, why are we here?
We find ourselves here, and I would agree with the other two that if we find ourselves here, we should assume responsibility for our lives and exult in the good things and do what we can to remedy the evil things.
Slightly more than 10 words, but very clear.
I don't see why this is a question I have to answer. It's not my problem.
not Charles Moore's problem. If God didn't create the universe, who did, gentlemen?
Oh, that you've changed the question, and that if I may say, is a silly question. The question you first asked is if the universe wasn't created by a supernatural agency of some kind, then what are we doing here? My answer is we're here to create meaning and to take care of one another.
Thank you very much. You could be nice to me later. Richard Dawkins.
If God didn't create the universe, who did? In a way, that's the whole point. That smuggling in of that word who is begging that huge question. Nobody created it, and if you try to postulate something like a God who did, then you've opened up an even larger question than the one you've solved. To answer the question of how did the universe come about by saying it was created by a God is to create a bigger question. It's to provide no answer at all. It's a non-answer.
Thank you very much indeed. Now, I think we've had an absolutely marvellous debate, superb questions from the floor. Therefore, I declare that the vote has been carried against.
I think now you need a combination.
It's working out essentially.